Welcome to e-Pachala lecture series on the subject computer science, and the paper what we are discussing is cryptography network security. In this module we are going to discuss about introduction to wireless LAN standards. The objectives are to introduce wireless networks and its topology, to learn about IEEE 802.11 standards, to discuss about various standards in WLAN and also the frame structure of WLAN technology. So, what is wireless network? So, generally we know so far the topic what we have discussed related with the internet technologies. If a person want to connect with an internet, they can be either directly connected to a wide area network or they can connect through the local area network. If the case where there is a wireless technology which makes them to connect with the internet, then they may belongs to the wireless LAN. So, wireless LAN or WLAN is the wireless local area network which uses radio waves as its carrier. So, here there are various advantages are there where the mobility is one of the feature of your wireless LAN. The people are free to move around the network with the connectivity without losing their connectivity. The last link with the end user is wireless to give a network connection to all user in the building or campus. So, usually these wireless LAN networks will be connected to a backbone network, usually using the cables. So, common topology where the wireless LAN, that is WLAN, connected to wired network. So, here we can understand the infrastructure, how your wireless nodes are connected to an access point, and through this access point they may be connected to a Ethernet or the internet network. So, here we are going to concentrating about this wireless stream, what kind of security issues are going to be faced and how a user can be protect their data when they want to access from this node to this access point. So, in this session Max, we are going to understand about how the connection is going to be established between access point and end user and what kind of frame structure they follow as different from their normal wired connection. So, that is we can able to understand, then we can able to know why there is a need for security, how we can able to provide security during the connection between your access point AP with the end user devices. So, here there is a need for an access point that will be acting as a bridge between your wireless user and the wireless wired network. So, access point is also similar to that of your devices where you call a repeater in the case of your wired network. Here also we are going to have, this will help you to doubling the maximum possible distance between the nodes. So, integration with the existing network where wireless access point or small device, it bridges the wireless traffic to your network. Suppose I need an internet connection where I can able to connect with an access point so that I can get the internet connection in wireless LAN. So, most access points bridge wireless LAN into the Ethernet, but some token rings are also available, some other Ethernet LAN technologies like token ring, token bus also optional, but majority of our access points are connected with your Ethernet technology. How it is different, why I need to go for, what are the benefits I will get with the help of WLAN? So, here we can able to see that they are specialized physical and data link layer. We know very well as there is a 7 layers in your OSI model. In that 7 layers, the lowermost first and the second layer, that is your physical layer and data link layer, their protocols are entirely different when compared to our wired network. And it is going to be providing an integration with the existing network. We do not have need to have any special infrastructure. Already on the existing network, we can able to provide the bridging function to make the end user to access with the internet. And also mobility is one of the major feature of your wireless technology, where you can able to see, you can roam from one coverage area to another coverage area without any disturbance in the connectivity. And also they have a unique security consideration when you are going to think about a security perspective, where it is an additional challenge for a security person to provide or secure their data, because anyone can able to get connected with our network. So there is a special care should be taken for providing a wireless network with a secured leave. That is another unique challenge where in the case of your wireless LAN. And interoperability, different hardware performance, everything is going to be somewhat different from our wired network to the wireless LAN. So we need to understand how these physical layer and data link layer are going to be different from the normal network where it is connected with wired. So wireless link where they are using with the network interface card, here we can able to see that it takes a frame of data from the link and scramble the data in the predefined way, then use the modified data stream to moderate a radio carrier signal. So in this case, we generally in the case of our wired network, we put the data in the wired medium like your copper cable, fiber optic or coaxial, but this case we are going to place our data in the radio carrier signal. So it is going to be taking some kind of frame structure where this is going to be having some predetermined way of representing the data in order to over modulating over the radio carrier string signal. So data link layer where it is having a special kind of an attention in terms of your wireless technology, here it having a collision avoidance. So meanwhile, we know about CSMA, that is there in the wired network also, but that case where we consider as carrier sense multiple access collision deduction, but here we are going to consider instead of deduction, there is the chance only for avoiding the collision which occurred during your transmission of two or more device. So here that was somewhat difference different from your wired network. So as we think of overall view, as we know very well, here it is going to have a wired network and access point is acting as a bridge, local bridge, and your devices must be enabled with wireless NIC card. You can able to see that laptop and desktop where each and every individual device there is no wired connection need a special kind of a network interface card which can able to send the radio signal and they can able to communicate with an access point. So here we have a new standard called 802.11 band and the layers and link layer and then media access layer, frame header and CSMDA CD, where in the case of your wide network and physical layer is going to be there. So when you are considering the 802.11 WLAN technology, where 802.11 standards, what are the different types of standards are available which we are going to adopt, that is what it is mentioned here, and their corresponding data rate with respect to transmission of the signal. As what here initially it is in 1997 802.11 where they used 1 Mbps and 2 Mbps with a band of 2.4 gigahertz. So it was initially done for wireless connection. Later they given a standard called 802.11b that in the year 1999 where 11 Mbps speed again in the same frequency band of 2.4 gigahertz where they call wireless Wi-Fi. Here they termed as an Wi-Fi, coined the name is wireless fidelity. And IEEE 802.11a where you can able to see here it is supporting only 11 Mbps speed. They want to go for improving the data rate as they want to devise a new standard where in the year same year as they have a 802.11a, it is coming with a different range of data rate. We can see 9, 6, 12, 18 and 54 Mbps in the 5 gigahertz band as ISM. And later we can able to see there is a 2001 to 2003 802.11g where the speed is up to 54 where it is in the ISM band of 2.4 GHz and also it is backward compatible with 802.11b. So actually why we got 802.11g, when we started using the wireless LAN with 802.11b, the devices which are coming with 802.11b, they are unable to adapt with 802.11a Similarly, a device which is enabled with 802.11a, they are not able to adopt with that interoperable with 802.11b. So, to overcome these difficulty, they want to come out with a new standard, that is what here in 2001 and 2003, they have a 802.11g, which is having the capability of 802.11a, but also in addition to that, it is also is a backward compatible with our 802.11b. So, whenever a device is having a standard of 802.11g, it is able to support both the A and B devices, where they can able to send their data interchangeably. So, here IEEE 802.11, it is a IEEE standard for wireless technology, what we are specified, will work on the license free industrial science medicine ISM band as the range where we can able to see that in the case of your 802.11, it is 2.4 gigahertz and 802.11a, it is 5 gigahertz band and 2.4 gigahertz in the case of your G. Like that, we can able to see that they are able to operate in the ISM band, it is a license free ISM band. And also some other wireless LAN technology also available, where we can see that high performance LAN or hyper LAN, where it is in the 5 gigahertz ISM, it is one version 1 is up to 24 and version 2 is up to 54 Mbps. And hyper LAN provides also quality of service, data, video, voice and images, where it is going to be supporting the QoS, quality of service for variety of data like your video, voice and images. And other technology where we have in the case of your WLAN is Bluetooth. So, here Bluetooth, again it is similar to that of your WLAN, but it is somewhat having a different characteristics or the features when compared to your WLAN. Here you can able to see that it is a ranges up to 100 meters only, that is where nowadays most of the phone, the mobile applications, we can able to see that there is Bluetooth technology which can able to transfer data within a shorter distance, which is less than 100 meters. And only the speed, you can able to see that here it is using only 740 kbps, that is kilobits when compared to our WLAN. WLAN is using Mbps, that is megabits per second at 2.4 giga ISM band, and applies fast frequency hopping, that is 1600 hops per second in the spectrum. So, and also the problem can have a serious interface with the 802.11 2.4 GHz range devices. Whenever we have such a devices are going to be available near the devices or the data transfer, it will be affecting the transfer rate or corrupting the data during the transmission of the data. So, we will see the overview of IEEE 802.11 layer structure. So, here we know it is going to be majorly concentrating on the lower two layer, as what here we can see that one is physical layer, another one is a data link layer. In this scenario, you can able to see that here we have a OSI model, where the layer 1, layer 2, and specifically we know that it is mainly taking the sub layer of your data link layer. Here we can able to see that there is a logical link control LLC and a MAC media access control, and part of our data link layer is our MAC, and it is going to be adopting for any technology whatever we are going to use it for our devices. As what here you can able to see that it is taking the physical and MAC layer, and ABG is the standard for 802.11. And similarly, you can able to see that this is our LAN technology, this is our token bus, token ring. So, the wire network as well as wired network where it is going to be operating within this particular range. So, in addition to that, we know about your bus, star and the ring topology, how these topologies are going to be used for connecting and also transferring the data during the data communication. This is the basic, we can say that architecture is a basic service set, BSS, basic service set, where how a device, basically when we want to talk about how the device can be communicated over a wireless medium, we have a two different type of structure, either going for a structure infrastructured or infrastructureless. So, basic service set is going to be providing the communication among the devices within that particular region, and also it is also specifying how they are organized, okay, that mentioning about whether it is going to be an infrastructured architecture or infrastructureless, that is what here it is mentioning. As you can able to see, these two different, one is ad hoc network, another one is infrastructure. Basically our WLAN, that is wireless LAN, is coming with AP as a central administrative control for communicating between these devices. Every device must be associated with an access point so that they can able to transfer the data. But in the case of your ad hoc mode, there is no centralized control where, and also there is no specific infrastructure, any device can be communicate with anyone. So that is why it is called ad hoc network. Here it is infrastructure network. Here it is mentioned basic service set without an access point. Here is basic service set with an access point. So whenever I want to communicate in the ad hoc mode, I can directly send the data to the destination. Even sometime it may go via hop or intermediate devices. So both the device can be act as router as well as the end device. And there is another service set called extended service set, where extended service set, your basic service set is going to be extended with the help of some distribution system, where there is a server. If they want to communicate, you can able to see that here each and every circle is mentioning about a single BSS, and these single BSS are interconnected via extended service set, ESS. So each and every node, for example, if this BSS 1, where I want a node to communicate to BSS 2, means that is happening through the distribution system as well as the access point where it is connected in the basic service set of the particular device. So as we look into the architecture, where 802.11 defines the physical, logical and media access for wireless local area network, and 802.11 network work as a, either it can be work as a BSS set or extended BSS set. How we are organizing, how we are going to make the device going to be connected, either in the case of architecture where I want to mention as BSS, we know very well there will be one region and one access point where the device are going to be connected. Extended means more than one BSS are going to be interconnected. And sometime it is also going to be in the form of ad hoc format. That means no need of any centralized control or a central point to communicate with the network device. And this where mentioning about 802.11, and this is an ad hoc mode and extended service set. The layer where it is having different the method of signaling, that is how it is going to be referring the signal, where it is going to be mentioned as FH, SS frequency hop spectrum, and also DSS direct sequence spectrum, and also IR, it is mentioning about an infrared light, where it is going to be used some kind of technology, use infrared for transmitting of the data. So in the case of our BSS and ESS, the ESS multiple access point may be connected by an access point and distributed system of Ethernet. And sometimes we can able to see there may be a overlapping, partially overlapping, or sometimes there may be a disjoint BSS. So now we can able to see here, as the case is the basic as an independent service set or a basic service set, where the device and their access points are going to be connected. And extended case, we can able to see either there is a chance of overlapping as what seen in the previous diagram, and disjoint, physically disjoint, there is no overlapping among the BSS, BSS 1 and BSS 2, and also physically co-located BSS also there is a working of this. So LLC provides an addressing and the data link control. This is where your logical link control, where it is providing how usually we know the device want to communicate, we need a MAC address. So the addressing and also the link control is going to be provided with help of your LLC, and the MAC will take care of access to the wireless medium, and also it is avoiding the collision when it is going to be happening, and also sometime it is going for priority based access, who can given what priority, 802.12, and joining the network. And mainly here we can able to understand the MAC is taking off your authentication and privacy among the nodes to communicate with the network. So services here, we have station service, some of the security service where we have authentication, privacy, and then we have some, then MSDU, that is where it is going to be your MAC service data unit within the access point in the ESS or BSS. And here you have a distributed system like association and participants to the distribution network. So now we can understand where exactly the security point of view, where we want to ensure our device, where it is connected to a secured environment or not with the help of this MAC. So MAC, media access control, will take care of providing authentication and privacy. To understand about that, definitely we need to know about the frame structure, how it is going to be providing the detailed control signals, control information related with our communication between the devices and the wireless medium. So physical layer, there are three, as we mentioned, three physical layer: FHSS, DSS and IR. Already we have mentioned, this is frequency hopping spectrum, direct sequence spectrum, and infrared transmission, which we are going to adopt for transmission of your data in the physical layer. So 802.11 channels and association. So usually an attacker will go for identifying what channel they are using for transmitting of the data, and also they will be mainly concentrating about your association, how a host is going to be associated with an access point. So these are the two places where the attacker will play for controlling or taking a control over the infrastructure or the device. So here we used to know about 802.11 range of, in case of if you take a B, standard B, 802.11B standard, 2.4 GHz to 2.85 GHz spectrum divided into 11 channels at different frequency. So access point admin choose a frequency for access point. So generally we don't know about this, automatically it is done by your access point. Sometimes we can also choose a channel. So there are totally 11 channels. So sometimes there is an interference possibilities are there, because if both the access points are closely located by the nearer, then automatically there is a interference may happen. So to avoid that, channels can be same as that chosen by the neighbor to be avoided. Whenever I am choosing a channel of a neighbor's channel, then there is a chance of interference, so it need to be avoided. And other point here is, as we know, associate, right, there are two things are going to be related with your host and the access point. One is association, another one is authentication. So basically a device, when it enter into the BSS, there is an access point, automatically it get associated with that. During the association, lots of conversations are going to be happening between your host and the access point. We can able to see that here, it scans the channel, listening for a beacon frame containing an access point name, that is called SSID, service identifier, and a MAC address. So this place is very, very sensitive, where an attacker can try to capture this information. From this information, they can able to perform any kind of threats to the network. And selecting an access point to associate with that, once they are exchanging this information, they will be selecting the association and may perform authentication if it is necessary. If your device is enabled with authentication, they will go for the step of authentication. Otherwise, it will be directly connected and typically run a DHCP to get an IP address in the access subnet. So when a device, we told that, right, so where we host want to associate with an access point, they use a beacons. A beacon frame is like your hello, right, hello message. Beacon frames, here we can able to see that beacon frames send from access point, it will be distributing, right, where it is saying access point, say I am available, I am available. So whenever a device, even if you go with a laptop, you can search for or scan for an Wi-Fi access, you can able to see a list of access points will be available in your mobile phone. So this is done with the help of a beacon frame. It's going to be periodically sending. So how we are going to get connected? There are two ways they can do. One is passive and then active scanning. So now currently what we are looking here is passive scanning. Right here we have a, imagine there are two BS, one is BSS 1 and another is BSS 2. We have an AP 1 and AP 2. There are two access points within BSS 1 and BSS 2. And host one. So beacon frame send from access point, and association request frame send when H12 access point Similarly, association recursion from the H12 access point. During the active scanning, where the probe here is a different signal, like not like your beacon. Here's probe is going to be sent from the device. You can able to see there, host one is sending a request for connecting with an access point. So probe is going to be sent, so that the probe responds from the frame set sent from the access point. And once the probe response given by the access point, who are giving the response, based on that the device is going to be associate. Once they get the response from the access point, started to associate the request from the send H12 and selecting the respective access point. So that is what the step given as 1, 2, 3, 4, that is it is mentioned here. So this is what active scanning. Active scanning means starting the scanning from the host machine. Passive scanning means where the beacons are sent by the access point, based on that we are going to start accessing their internet connectivity. So related with the frame structure of 802.11, we have a addressing. Here we know very well about your frame structure. We have control frame, that is frame control duration, and address 1, 2, 3, like that we have 4 address. We can able to see that normally when you have a wide network we have only 2 address, but here we can able to see that there are 4 address. So this point where we need to understand how we are get connected according to the architecture, where we say either it's a BSS or ESS, and then the other information like your sequence number and your CRC where it is going to be given, and payload is nothing but which is coming from the upper layer, that like your network layer where it is providing the data. So we need to know what is this address 1, address 2, address 3 and address 4. Address 1 is the MAC address of wireless host or access point to receive from the frame. So here we can able to see that address 1 is MAC address of wireless host or access point to receive this frame. Address 2 is MAC address of wireless host or access point transmitting this frame. Address 3 is MAC address of router interface to which the AP is attached, and address 4 is used only in ad hoc mode. So this is only in ad hoc mode. So normally the 1, 2, 3 is the address where we used in the case of your WLAN. So this is the way how your device is going to be connected to the internet if it is going to be in your access point. So here we can able to see that we have 3 address. Address 1, that is where the host, where it is going to be having the access point MAC information, host is sending, and H1 MAC address is going to be there from bit is where it is receiving. This is your destination, this is your source, and this third is your MAC address where it is going to be forwarding to the destination. Once it is getting that, router 1, that is your destination MAC address. Here is wired network, because its backbone is always wired network. It has 2 address. One is your router, one is the destination, and access point H1 MAC is your source where it is going to be sent. Apart from that, we have some additional information where it is having the sequence number as well as some control signal for avoiding the collision, like your RTS and CTS, request to send and control to send. So here it is mentioning about how it is avoiding the collision, because detection the collision is not possible in the case of your wireless network. Here it start set the backoff to 0, that is the algorithm where it is waiting time, it is run with the waiting time, backoff to 0, persistence strategy, wait for the interframe where it is going to be used between your sender and the receiver, and send the request to send. Then it sets the timer. So based on the timer where it is going to be, CTS received before the timeout. Suppose clear to send is sending by the device, then they can go for, if it is not send, if it is send yes before timeout, yes, it will go for wait for SIF of the interframe, send the frame, set the timer and acknowledge success. But if it is not getting any clear to send, then it is going for the incrementing of your backup. If the backup is limit yes about, otherwise it will go for the next process. So this is the way where they can able to avoid the collision in the case of our, this is what carrier sends multiple access collision avoidance flow chart, where it is explaining with respect to our backoff algorithm and also 2 interframes like your DIF and SIF, where it is used for identifying is the channel is free or not before sending their data. So this is what the flow, where you can able to see that source and the destination. First the source will send RTS, it will check for the SIF frame, interframe, and the CTS is going to be replied, and if it is going to be receiving that frame within that duration, then it starts sending the data. Once it receives the data, it will go for the acknowledgement. Is an NVA that is going to be giving understanding of NVA is a information or a control frame where network allocation vector, which will be identifying the ideal of the channel, whether it is the channel is ideal or somebody is already using that, whether it is going to check the busy or ideal of the channel. So, according to the address where we have 4 addresses in the frame, so here how it is going to be set, okay, for example, whether it is going to the DS or from the DS. Okay, 00 means where you can able to see that address is 1, it is saying that destination source is the second address BSS ID, and in the case of ad hoc mode only the 4th address is going to be used, so we can avoid that. And we have 01, if I am sending that the control frame to set 2 is 0 and from is 1, then destination address address 1 and sending API and the source where it is going to be address 3. Similarly, 10 receiving API, source and the destination, but in the case of 11 where you can see that the first address is address of receiving API, sending API, second address, destination and the source. So, this is what the address information, how they understand whether which is what, how the frames are going to be sent between access point and the host. So, this is what addressing mechanism, DS distributing system, distribution system we can able to see here. So, here the case 1, no distribution system. So, it is sending B to A, only 2 address and BSS ID. And in the case of distribution system, we can able to see that B, A, P and A. So, B, A, P and A from one extended ESS case, this is case 2, and then here again how it is returned back, replied, and in the case of your ad hoc mode, how it is done in the case of your ad hoc mode. So, overall we can understand that what is a wireless network and its topologies, and also we understood what are the standards are available like 802.11a b g, how it is going to be used, and various frame structures are be used in the same of addressing the devices. Thank you.